Good afternoon. Welcome to Eureka College. My name is Phil Acre Cavalier, and I'm the provost and dean of the college, and it's great to see so many people out on a four-degree Tuesday at 12:30 with slushy and icy roads. Thank you for all for coming here. We're honored today to have with us Dr. Temple Grandin, an internationally recognized and sought-after thought leader in animal science and autism. While many people only dream of becoming a leading voice in one field during their lives, Dr. Temple Grandin has become a leading voice in two. She has spent her career recasting the way that we understand and interact with both animals and people with autism, and she has created a remarkable body of writing that speaks to experts and to lay people. She's helped us see the animal world through the animal's eyes, and has shown us that we can design machines based on principles of human caring and empathy. In a passage describing her first day using a new piece of cattle equipment she had designed, Dr. Grandin writes, quote, "Through the machine, I reached out and held the animal. When I held his head in the yoke, I imagined placing my hands on his forehead and under his chin and gently easing him into position. Body boundaries seemed to disappear, and I had no awareness of pushing the levers. The rear pusher gate and head yoke became extensions of my hands," end quote. Dr. Grandin has also shown us how an autistic brain encounters the world. Describing her own mental world, she says, quote, "My mind works just like an internet search engine that has been set to access only images. The more pictures I have stored in the internet inside my brain, the more templates I have of how to act in a new situation," end quote. Through her work and in her writing, Dr. Grandin shows us that autism gives her gifts of thinking and seeing differently that have had a profoundly positive effect on the world around her. Her impact and influence have been recognized by many organizations over the last 20 years. In 2010, Time magazine recognized Dr. Grandin's impact by naming her as one of the 100 most influential people in the world. In 2004, she was named one of the 40 most influential people in the beef industry, and in 2009, she was inducted into the Meat Industry Hall of Fame. She has received honorary degrees from Duke University, McGill University, University of Illinois, Arizona State, and her alma mater, Franklin Pierce College. She has appeared on 60 Minutes, 2020, Larry King Live, and National Public Radio, been featured in the New York Times, Forbes, U.S. News and World Reports, and People magazine, and given a TED Talk in 2010. She has authored 9 books, numerous book chapters, and hundreds of articles in academic journals and trade magazines. She is currently professor of animal science at Colorado State University. Please join me in welcoming a brilliant thinker, teacher, and writer, Dr. Temple Grandin.
It's great to be here today. I'm getting over a cold, so I'm going to have to keep taking these drinks, try to keep me going. Got some hot tea in that because I've still got a hoarse voice. Well, today I'm going to be talking about handling animals. Now, this worked before. Now, one of the things I can't emphasize enough in handling an animal is having a calm animal. Doesn't matter what kind of animal you're handling. Calm cattle, calm cats, calm dogs, horses are easier to handle than very excited ones. Now, in the nice introduction I just got, they emphasize some of the facilities I've designed. But I want to emphasize, facilities are half of the equation. The other half of the equation is how people operate those facilities. Because when I was young, when I was in my 20s, I used to think that I could fix everything with the right equipment. What I've learned now is I can only fix about half of the stuff with equipment. In fact, I used to just tear my hair out trying to get people to operate equipment right. You know, sometimes the management is more important than the facilities. Now, if you get your animal all scared and excited, it's going to take 20 minutes for it to calm back down. So don't get it all scared and excited. You know, we'll talk about horses and cattle being agitated. Well, what is agitation when you're handling an animal? It's fear. Sometimes people don't want to use that little fear word, but it's a scientifically correct word. Because you go over into the neuroscience literature, they use that word. Sometimes in animal husbandry, veterinary medicine, they avoid that word, but it is a proper word. Now, how can you tell? Well, let's get it back up now. How can you? I don't know what's going on with this. How can you tell if your animal is getting scared? Well, when it's getting scared, you'll see the whites of its eyes. That is a scientifically documented measure of fear in cattle. It's been very well documented. It's probably about 4 scientific papers on that now. Now, what are some other signs that horses or cattle are getting scared? The tail will be swishing. Well, in dogs, the tail wagging is friendly, but not in horses and cattle. They're getting excited. That's your warning. They're getting ready to kick you. Heads up, ears pinned back, skin's quivering. Maybe the horse's nostrils are flaring. What I want you to do is become better observers for a little visual detail. What is your animal attending to? What does your animal look like? You know, what is he looking at? You know, get aware of a whole world that's not words. You want to understand animal behavior. You got to get away from words. It's sensory based. A little world of pictures, of sound clips, smell whiffs. I mean, think about what the dog's learning when he goes to the local tree. It's sort of like going down to the local coffee shop. He knows who's been there. Are they a friend or a foe? Who's the big, dominant one? Now, in some of my early work, I noticed that cattle would often refuse to go through a facility if you had a piece of chain hanging down in that facility. Or maybe there was a metal strut going across the ground. Or a vehicle was parked next to the facility. Lots of times you get rid of these distractions in a facility, they'll move through it much more easily. And a calm animal will show you these things. Now why, after 40 years of doing talks, I've been doing this now for 4 decades, why do I still need to talk about a chain hanging down? Because people are not taking them out. I'm still going out to ranches, and these things are still there. Animals will tend to stop, put the head down, when there's a change in flooring. Now, I realize you can't get rid of every change in flooring, but if they're balking, maybe going from dirt to concrete, then put some dirt up on the concrete so it's not such a sharp line. Here's a bad reflection. We're going right into the sun, so you can get time of day effects. Maybe at 10 o'clock in the morning, it's fine. 11 o'clock in the morning, it's not okay. You know, time of day effects can affect it. Get down in that chute and see what they're seeing. On this real sunny day, you got shadows. Cloudy day, you won't have shadows. Is there a vehicle parked next to it? You've got people there deep in the flight zone. Now, if they're a bunch of tame show steers or show cows, well, then they don't have a flight zone. That's the kind of cattle you want to lead with the bucket. And at lunch, we were talking about some of those cattle where you just shake the bucket to lead them through. But if those animals have some flight zone and people stand there in the flight zone, then the cattle are going to be in the chute, you know, kind of going like this because they don't like it that the cattle people are standing too close. Then you need to get out of the way. Either cover up the side or get the people out of the way. But you don't want to have people just standing in the flight zone. Okay, how many people there noticed that that animal was not walking on the sunbeam? How many people noticed that? I want to try to get you to be more observant. Okay, up there on the top, we got a pig facility. When the sun's out, you got the shadows. Other times, you don't have the shadows. This is what I call the black hole. Sunny on the outside, dark inside the building. And they don't want to go in. Now, at night, this will work just fine if you light it up with some lights. Animals tend to go towards the light. I was just talking to a veterinarian at lunchtime today, and at night, the way he gets his cattle to go where he wants them to go is he puts a headlamp on, and then they go where the headlamp is. You know, that's an example of moving towards the light. But they're not going to go into blinding light, like looking at the sun coming up over the top of a truck. Now, what are the ways that can help you to get those animals to come in is take some of the metal siding off so they can see natural daylight through the building. That will help, especially on sunny days. Right here, they've put in some white translucent plastic. that lets in light without having all the shadows. Now, I always get asked, do cattle know they're going to get slaughtered? That's a question that the public asks all the time. And I found that cattle behave the same way at the slaughterhouse as they behave going in the veterinary chute. Yes, and there is some stress. I just recently reviewed the literature on the stress hormone levels, on the cortisol levels, at a slaughterhouse and at the farm during handling. Yes, there's stress, but it's the same in both places. And the new literature also reflects the same thing. Now, how many people noticed that the people were standing where they shouldn't be standing? You know, sometimes the most obvious is the least obvious. Things might work a whole lot better if you just got those people out of the way. Now, one good thing in this picture is they've got the white translucent plastic inside the tunnel. Now, this shows, I hope I can get the pointer here to work. Okay, shows a curved facility. Where the solid side is most important is to go around that outside perimeter. You know, because someone parks a car next to it, they're not going to go. Now, some people make the inner radius here partially open. And if you do that, then you got to stay out of this whole area, because otherwise you'll be standing in the flight zone. It's really important. Lay things out correctly. I have a book called Humane Livestock Handling that shows layouts. I also have lots and lots of designs on my website, Grandin.com. It's just my last name, Grandin.com. All I can say is it's certainly going to be nice when I get over having this hoarse voice. This is not very much fun. Okay, when you lay out a round crowd pen, it's really important to lay it out in the full half circle, because cattle have a natural tendency to go back to where they come from. Now, a lot of people build a, have a tub that's built inside a building. When you come in like this and then around, you might want to try working it from the center pivot point. Because when you work it from the center pivot point, you can make the cattle come on around. And we were discussing some of the common layout mistakes. And by working from the center pivot point, that will compensate for some of those layout mistakes. And then your system's going to work. Now, you'll notice right there that backstop's tied open. People tend to put too many backstops in facilities. You know, backstops stop them from backing up, but they also make cattle balk. And especially there at the entrance. You can also hook a backstop up to a remote control rope so you can lift it up, and then the cattle will come in. Another basic principle is you want to use a crowd pen as a passing through pen. Wait until you've got space in here, and then just bring the cattle up, and they go right on around. If your single file's all full and you fill it up with cattle, they're all going to turn around on you. Now, one really simple improvement that will make a lot of facilities work a whole lot better is making sure you have enough single file chute space. Nothing is worse than a single file chute that holds one animal. Then I put four animals in the crowd pen, they all turn around. If you lengthen that single file just a little bit, so that you can put four cattle in a single file, then I can bring them in through that crowd pen and just keep them going using the following behavior. People need to understand the flight zone. Okay, that tame animal that's hauled or broke, it's got no flight zone at all. You got some wild animal, you get too close to it, tries to turn back on you, that's because you're in the flight zone. And you can really see this flight zone in this shape. Now, here is a really handy way to get animals to go forward. They're lined up in the chute. And what you do, here's your squeeze chute. You step forward, quickly walk back by them. So make a quick movement like that. If I step forward like this and stop there, when I cross the balance line on the first animal, it will go forward. And then I can stop these from coming in. But it's got to be kind of quick. Because if you don't do it kind of quick, it's not going to work. I'll show you doing it way too slow.
Well, when you do that, then they just back up on you
when you do it too slow. But you just take a step forward, quickly walk back by them. And when you're right up close to them in the chute, that point of balance is going to be at the shoulder. Now, right there, I'm just demonstrating turning an animal with a flag. People get way too rough with driving aids. I want you to stop screaming, stop whistling. Just move it gently to turn the animal. A calm animal will turn. When cattle get all excited and they're all stuck together like glue, it's not going to work. You see, to learn low-stress handling methods, and there's a lot of people out there now teaching low-stress handling methods. But the first thing you got to do is you got to calm down and not be yelling and screaming at them. Because yelling and screaming is going to raise their stress hormones. Animals know the difference between people yelling at them and a gate closing. They know that people yelling at them is directed at them. And that tends to get them upset. Another basic principle is... Now, fill your crowd pen that leads up to your single file chute half full. Half full. Don't jam it full. Good handling. That's going to require a lot more walking. A lot of times people don't want to do more walking. But you're going to have to do more walking to do good handling. The principle is why don't you try just putting the crowd gate about there. Bring them on around. And then right up the chute without stopping. When you go to load a truck, get all your gates ready, get everything ready. Then just bring them up and just keep moving. Because if you bring them up there and you fill up the crowd then, guess what they're going to do? They're going to all turn around on you. Now notice this guy's standing back. That's really good. Because if he stands up here, the animals are not going to go forward. But people tend to overuse the crowd gates, tend to push the crowd gates too much. Watch what the animals are doing with their ears. You can see right there the horse and the zebra have an ear on each other. Now, where do you think that other ear is? It's on me. That's where your other ear is. Here are some behavioral principles working animals. I cannot emphasize enough the importance of non-slip flooring. Animals panic when they start to slip. You get in there and they're just going like this, going like this. Sudden jerky motion scares. Another mistake that's made with hydraulic chutes is squeezing animals way too hard. There's an optimal pressure. You need to make it tight enough so they feel held, but not so tight that it hurts. And the wilder animals, then you may want to cover up the side. Well, you might want to try a real simple thing. Try covering the back half of the squeeze chute. Because you're standing here like this, you cover that back half, then they don't see you standing there. My students did some of the very first work on cattle temperament. The research is very clear. Cattle that get all excited and jump around in squeeze chutes and cattle that run out really fast have lower weight gain. You know, cattle that get crazy easily have lower weight gain. But on the other hand, you probably don't want to just turn all the beef cattle into Holsteins because we've got wolves out in the West now. Cow needs to protect her calf. And one of my students found, Connie Flurka, found that there's individual differences in how a cow will protect her calf. Some are very vigilant, some call the calf, and there's a few cows that just don't care about their calf at all, which is not good at all. But we need to be careful about over-selecting. Temperament's an important trait. I want to get rid of the crazies, but you don't want to just turn them all into, you know, Holsteins. Now, this is a really, really important concept. When an animal voluntarily cooperates with something that we're doing, you're not going to have all this fear stress. When you force cattle to do things, you're going to have a lot more fear stress. You know, take your young heifers and walk them through the handling facility so they get used to going through it. Make sure their first experience in the handling facility is a good first experience. Because if their first experience is a bad first experience, you may get a fear memory and the animal will have a hard time getting over that. Okay, beef cattle, lots of prods. Dairy cattle, well, that's lower. Genetics. Also, dairy animals voluntarily cooperate. Here's our trained antelope. We trained antelope to cooperate with blood sampling and with veterinary work, and they don't get scared now. Okay, an animal's first experience with you, new equipment, let's say the four-wheeler, new pickup truck, whatever, needs to be a good first experience. Because that first experience of the four-wheeler is really terrible, like chasing them all over the pasture with it. Then they're going to be afraid of that four-wheeler. Now, I realize sometimes we've got to do painful stuff, but it's really important that that's not the first thing that we do with the cattle when they first introduce something new. First experiences can really have a bad fear memory. Now, new things are both scary and attractive. I put this paper down there, clipboard on the paper. They all came up to it. Wind blows the paper, they run away. I call it curiously afraid. You know, come up to it, then run away. Well, they actually were being curiously afraid. The brain was switching back and forth between fear and the tendency to approach novelty. Novelty is attractive when they voluntarily approach. And novelty is scary when you shove it suddenly in an animal's face. And an animal that's got a flighty genetics is going to have a bigger reaction to something. You know, people will say to me, well, my steer was fine at home and he went berserk at the show. So maybe the old Hereford, he's fine at the show. But something with a little more flightiness is going crazy because he wasn't acclimated to things like flags, bikes, and balloons before he went to the show. I call those the big three really scary things. And what would be the best way to get your animals trained to something like flags? Well, decorate his pasture with flags and let the horses and the cattle come up to it, voluntarily approach. Take a bicycle and just walk it through the pasture. Get them accustomed to those things. But animal thinking is very specific. If you train the animal to tolerate a blue and white umbrella, that does not switch over to a tarpaulin. Okay, cows that are used to being fed range cubes, okay, they're used to people there, may still freak out in the squeeze chute. See, it is very specific. Well, there's an example of an umbrella being a sudden novel stimulus. Those horses have really low fear genetics, so it didn't make them do much of a reaction. The animal that's likely to have the biggest reaction when you suddenly introduce novelty is the one with the flighty genetics. Okay, where does flighty genetics get separated from common genetics? It's when you suddenly introduce something new. The flighty genetics is going to have a much bigger reaction. A big problem I've seen with cattle raised out west, and we were also talking about some problems at lunch, with cattle from Florida, is animals that see their first man on foot at a sell barn or packing plant. See, think about it. Man on a horse is a different picture than man on the ground. It's really important to get cattle accustomed to both long before they leave the ranch, because it's super dangerous at a packing plant to have some animals come in that now have a 50-foot flight zone and you're in a 20-foot pen and they're trying to run back on top of you. You need to get them trained to both people on foot and people on the horses. Animal thinking specific, same thing with four-wheelers. Let's get them trained that four-wheelers are okay. Let's give you another example of animal thinking being specific. There was a police dog that was trained to guns going off, but when there was fireworks or a thunderstorm, he was under the cruiser. In other words, guns he'd learned, that was okay, but fireworks, that was like really scary. Now, how do we keep standards high? One of the things really drives me crazy is I go out to a place and I put in a great facility, get it working just beautiful, come back a year later and the hot shots were out again. And what had happened is handling had slowly gone back bad. It had slowly gone back bad, but people didn't realize it. I call that bad becoming normal. That's one of the reasons why I want to measure handling. That's one of the reasons why we need to measure things like lameness in dairy cows. How the dairy industry's got like a 25% lameness rate in certain parts of the country. How'd they get into a mess like that? It slowly went bad. They got so used to seeing it, they didn't realize it. What I found on training people on handling cattle, if I just take a bunch of people and you train them, about 20% will stay good. You show them low stress stockmanship, they just do it. Then there's a whole bunch of other people you gotta keep supervising them. And then there's maybe 10% of people that maybe shouldn't be handling animals. They like to rough them up. So I've become a big proponent of numerical scoring. And this has worked super well at the meat plants. Now, if any of you are involved in writing guidelines for anything, we got to get rid of these horrible words. What does sufficient space mean? What does proper handling mean? I see these kind of words written down. I don't know what that means. We need to write things that are clear. I like to use traffic rules as a model. Traffic rules work. And they work pretty well in every state because they're clear. Stop means stop. Speed limit means you have maybe a 5%, you know, over, and that's it. You know, that's sort of no, but that's clear. I've traveled all over the U.S., I've traveled all over the world, and I've never seen a sign that says drive at a safe speed, or drive prudently, or drive with care, or any other kind of nonsense. But I see that in animal welfare guidelines. I see that in guidelines for, you know, lots of different things. All right, here's an example of something's clear. All the pigs have to have enough space to lay down without being on top of each other. That's clear. Don't just say, give them enough space. Now let's score animal handling. How many animals run? I want cattle walking and trotting. How many animals fall during handling? How many animals moo during handling? You have animals mooing when you just catch them in the squeeze chute, you're hurting them. And how many animals have used an electric prod on? Now my student, Ruth Woliwody, just finished up a survey. It's now published in Beef Magazine. She went to 28 feed yards. And she looked at handling. She watched 100 cattle going through the squeeze chute. Electric prod score was like 5.5% for all the yards. I averaged, that's really good. Falling was about 0.8%. Vocalization was under 5%. It had really good results. The average for the 28 feed yards in Kansas, Nebraska, and Colorado was under the beef quality assurance recommendations. That is real good news. Things have improved. But unfortunately, at one of the feed yards, there was a 20-year-old kid wearing earphones, jigging to the music, that decided he's going to rip out ear tags without cutting them first and tore the cattle's ears. That would not have looked very good on YouTube. I think we got to look at everything we do and say, how's that going to play on a telephone video on YouTube? Well, that wouldn't look very good ripping their ears up when the other 27 yards did a great job. Now, unfortunately, truck driving, that's a nasty area. There's a brand new article in the Journal Animal Science about high hotshot use. Truckers coming in at night loading out cattle, and nobody's supervising it. You know, our survey showed good news in the cattle handling where the managers are supervising it a whole lot more. Kansas State University did a survey that came out with just about identical results. You see, the thing is, you manage the things you pay attention to. But I'm a big believer in measuring handling because I don't want the hotshot use and stuff like that to gradually creep back up. And I'll tell you where I'm adamant. No hotshots in your hand. It's not your primary dry make tool. You only pick up a hotshot if the cow absolutely won't go in the squeeze chute. Then you pick up the prod shot, you use it, and then you put it away. I'm not going to suggest banning them. I've seen too many tails busted, too many sticks up the butt, and all kinds of things like that. But get it out of your hand. You know, and tail cranking and all that kind of stuff. There's a time where it'd be better to buzz the cow once. Or the real tame ones, once you get the feed bucket out and shake it. But let's measure handling. Because then I can tell, is my electric prod score gradually going up? Is my falling score getting worse because the floor in front of the squeeze chute ran out? I'm a big proponent of measuring. Because early in my career, I thought I could fix it all with equipment. Now I've got to call this installing the management software. You know, you can just go, well, what was my score? If you catch them around the head, they're going to moo. If you squeeze them too hard, they'll moo. If cattle moo right when you catch them, you're hurting them. Now, obviously, if you brand them or you maybe stick an ear tag in, that might make them moo. But you should be able to get them in the squeeze chute, catch them without them mooing. Okay, if they're mooing going in, it's because you poked them with a prod. And you smash them on the head with the head gate, they'll moo. You know, that should be 5% or less. Okay, this is a measurement system that's been very successful with the meatpacking plants. It's sort of like traffic rules for slaughter plants. I guess now we're supposed to call them harvest facilities. I thought that was something we only did with grain. I don't know. I'm willing to sanitize it a bit and call them meat plants. Well, and I think we need to show stuff works. I've got videos up on YouTube, beef plant video tour with Temple Grandin, pork plant video tour with Temple Grandin, and we got about 90,000 views on the beef plant video tour. I know some FFAs can't get YouTube, so AMI does have free DVDs available. But this is traffic rules. Okay, you want to pass a McDonald's audit, you got to shoot 95% on the first shot. Well, that's like real clear. And when we first started doing this, the main reason why people failed was broken equipment. Not the design of equipment, broken equipment. And you better get them dead before you cut things off them. How many animals did you poke with the prod? Localization score has to be under 5%. And falling has to be under 1%. And you know, the big plants now, they're making their numbers. Where we got some of the problems now, we got some of the little plants now that I got to fix some of their stuff. Now, the thing I like about using these numbers is whether I audit a plant or you audit a plant, we're getting the same results. You know, the problem we got now with the USDA is they're coming out with a new guidance document. Minimize discomfort with electric prods. Minimize excitement with electric prods. I don't know exactly what that means. They've taken that right out of the regs. Minimize discomfort. Well, if it's mooing when you poke it, I'm going to call that discomfort. Maybe we need to start giving some definitions for that stuff. In 1996, only 30% of the plants could shoot the 95% because of the busted equipment. Now, some animal rights people will distort this and say, well, you mean you're allowed to cut up the other 5% alive? No. You have to immediately give a second shot. Now, it's been really good. Now, Cargill and JBS now have video auditing, where auditors over the internet can check in. Because when we first started, announced and unannounced audits, we had the same scores. People just knew, didn't know what some of the stuff they were doing was bad. And then they learned how to cheat about 5 years later. So now we need to be doing the video auditing. I'm so sick and tired of going in a plant. Okay, horse slaughter plants, for example. Real controversial. I go in a horse slaughter plant. When I'm standing there, it's working perfectly. Then a week later, one of the activist groups gets in there and they're whipping a horse in the face. Well, all I can say is that when I was there, they were not doing that. So all I can say, at least the equipment in that plant is capable of doing a decent job. See, this gets back to management. The older I get, the more and more I'm getting on management. If I had a choice between what would I rather have, state-of-the-art equipment and crappy management, or average equipment, just so-so equipment, and superb management, I'll take the average equipment with the superb management. Now, obviously, we can't have forklift pallets tied together with baling wire as cattle facilities. And this morning we were talking about a farm that had a squeeze chute and nothing leading up to it. Well, now you're going to get the cattle into that. You do have to have something better than that. Now, the principle of this, I can't get this back up. I want to back that up. The principle here is we're measuring five things. It's like traffic rules. The principle is you measure five simple things that measure a multitude of sins. Let's look at vocalization. They can moo because they poked them with an electric prod. They can moo because you bashed them on the head with a head gate. See, what you're doing here is you're measuring outcomes. I'm not telling you how to build things. See, the old way of doing audits is to tell you how to build stuff. There are going to be a few things I can tell you cannot do. But other than that, I'm not going to tell you how to build stuff. If you can use a toilet paper facility and make it work, that's fine. Don't think that's going to work very well. Think about traffic. Let's say we got this police department that's real poor, and they're only going to enforce three things. These are the three things I'd think about. What do you think the three most important things to enforce for traffic safety would be? Someone want to give me the, want to get you thinking in the critical control point approach. In other words, what is a really important thing to measure? Speeding, yes, I'd agree with that. Parking tickets, no. Running red lights, yes. And then the third thing would be impaired driving. Yeah, texting would be included in that. Now the thing is, this is not a paperwork audit. The thing that's driving me crazy today with so many regulatory things is they want to turn everything into a paperwork stupidity thing. Well, that doesn't fix anything because they just fake up the paperwork. In fact, when the video auditing was first put in the big plants, there's about 8 big plants out there was put in. 2 of them were caught faking the internal audits. Yeah, they worded a little more delicately. The subjective audits didn't match the results of the objective audits over the internet. And I'm going, yeah, I think some of the audits got made up in the office. Holstein dairy cows, 0% prod score for 10 audits in a row. I don't believe that. But the thing is, I want to put the emphasis on stuff I can directly observe. One of the big problems we've got on so many things is we're getting people involved in stuff where it's all theory. Oh, don't get me started on, you know, government stuff. You know, I'm glad that this university doesn't give any degrees out in public administration. And we talked about that yesterday before I was going to trash that, because the thing is, you mean you actually can get a degree in bureaucracy? Like, man, you got to be kidding. Degree in bureaucracy. That's, no way. You know, we've got too many people, you know, in charge of stuff that don't know, like, what it's like to do real things. Okay, I can use measurement where I can change something and then, well, then things improve. Okay, I got air blowing in the cattle's face and I fix that and I drop the vocalization score from 4.5% down to 0 because they no longer had prods put on them. I put a light on a dark entrance and the percentage of pigs I had to poke with an electric prod went from 38% down to 4. All I did was duct tape a light on the entrance. Now, of course, I had people that were well-trained, and they only used that prod when the pigs refused to go. This is my center track restrainer system for big plants. You can look at this on Beef Plant Video Tour. Now, the reason I'm putting this up here, detail of design is important. Always fussing about, well, a non-slip ramp coming in here. Then people take the cleats off. You, this thing is 8 foot off the floor. You've got to make sure the cattle don't look down and go, ah, a cliff. So you've got to have a false floor in here. People will change stuff on the design, and then it doesn't work. And the thing that I find is they'll take stuff off and change it, stuff that's on there just for a behavior reason. You know, a real difficult concept to try to get across is use behavior rather than force. Well, neither babies nor animals are going to go out over the visual cliff. Even though that glass is very solid, they don't want to go out on it. Okay, I put a light on the entrance of a restrainer. I went from 8% down to 0. I put the false floor back on. I went from 9% mooing due to electric prods down to 0. I reduced pressure on a neck restrainer, 23% mooing down to 0. I could track the improvement. Now there's an example there of, I don't know why I can't get this to back up. There's an example there of the light. Okay, there's just an example of light. Notice how it's pointed. It's not going in the cattle's eyes. It's lighting up the way in front of them. There's also differences. I don't know why I'm having so much trouble with this. Okay, back it up. Maybe you could back it up. Okay, I missed a slide, then we'll just stick with that. Okay, this is a really important thing. You know, let's say we're going to look at things out on the farm. Let's look at outcome measures. What are important outcome measures on a farm? Body condition score of breeding cows, lameness. I never thought lameness would be a problem in beef cattle, but unfortunately, I've seen some problems at the packing plants caused by beta agonists with lame feedlot cattle. Big issue with dairy cattle. Lots of different things can cause it. Filthy, dirty animals. Now, one place where there's some good news is the amount of animals showing up with cancer eye. That has gone down. That's one place where producers are doing a much better job. But the thing that's really bad is you'll have Holsteins showing up at a packing plant in really rotten condition, and beef takes the rap for it. People don't realize that those are dairy cattle. It's not a good thing. Organic people, no. It's not okay in the spring to have bald spots on animals. That's not okay. Indoor facilities, ammonia levels, 10 parts per million is what the animal should have. Safety regulations, 25 parts per million. Abnormal behavior, that's usually not an issue with beef. Okay, lameness is a really good outcome measure because look at all the things that can cause lameness. You know, I'm not going to measure the other things. If I got a problem, it's going to show up in the failed lameness score. And then you have some practices we just don't allow. I mean, sell just station stalls, that's a real controversial thing. You're just not going to sell that one to the public. Okay, if we're in the slaughterhouse, there's some things we should not be doing. Hanging cattle up by their ankles alive. Okay, that's something we don't do. I was on the World Animal Health Organization Slaughter Committee. I said, we got to write down some things we don't do. How about poking out eyes? You got to remember, this is for the whole world. How about cutting tendons on beef cattle? I mean, these are things we got to just come out and say we just don't do some of this really awful stuff. You know, I want to get away from a lot of minutiae telling you how to build handling facilities. But they can come out and say, well, there's some things that maybe we shouldn't be doing. And I don't know how we got back to the beginning again. I don't know how that happened now. Okay, we're just going to have to leave it. The last slide there was my website, Grandin.com. It's just my last name, Grandin.com. TempleGrandin.com is an autism site. Grandin.com is my livestock site. And I do have a book on cattle handling, humane livestock handling. You can pick that up on Amazon. I've also got a book that some professors might be interested in, Improving Animal Welfare, Practical Approach. And it's kind of a textbook on how to, in a practical way, implement animal welfare. You know, I'm all about, we've got to do things that are sensible and practical. Unfortunately, one of the things I've learned on being on these committees, people, the worst producers get on there to water down standards. I mean, one of the worst ones I ever saw is somebody wanted to put in a standard that a pig farm could have 10% bone rack sows and pass a welfare audit. Well, who has that many bone rack sows and would even be in business? I mean, that's like totally ridiculous. I think we got to look at what we do and say, how would that play with your guests from Chicago? A well-run slaughter plant actually passes the test. You know, the only thing that is a problem is the smell, and I'm really glad the beef plant video tour doesn't have smell-o-vision. Okay, now what I'd like to do is just open it up for some questions. And I hope you've been able to understand me. It's really a pain having such a hoarse voice. Okay, I'm going to pick somebody. Oh, you've been really attentive. How about you right there? Well, the question is, what do I do if people aren't receptive? What I have found, people are much more receptive to buying the new piece of equipment, lots of times, than to operating it right. You know, this is something I've learned over my career. Like the new computer, the new drug, the new milking parlor, whatever the thing is, gonna magically fix all their management problems. You know, now there's some places that really are interested in changing things. Now, when I worked with McDonald's in 1999, on implementing the McDonald's audits, when we implemented that animal welfare scoring, they had to do it. And one of the reasons why it worked is the auditing was very simple. It was just like traffic rules. They had to make certain numbers. It was strict, but it was sensible. And the good news is that out of 75 plants, only 3 had to build something expensive. All of the others we fixed with non-slip flooring, lighting, adding lights, moving lights, and putting up solid panels in the right place. And then there were 3 plants out of the 75 where the plant manager had to be removed because that was the main problem. But it's a big problem. I have veterinary students ask me all the time, well, okay, they're working for this dairy or whatever. You know, what do you do if they're doing terrible things to the animal? Well, the problem that veterinarian has is they get too vocal about it, then they may just fire that veterinarian. Or they want the veterinarian to defend all the bad stuff they do. That is really a problem. When I was working all the time installing equipment, oh man, some of the worst stuff I ever saw people do, they did in brand new facilities. You know, it was very, very, very frustrating for me. You know, what kept me going was the 20% of people that did things right. I think today, people are getting a much more awareness of handling. You know, the study that my student Ruth did, that's in Beef Magazine, it just came out in it, and Kansas State study showing an improvement. That is good. Truck drivers at 3 o'clock in the morning is still a big problem area because nobody's supervising them. Okay, right there.
Are
When I first started in my 20s, a question concerned one that I realized it, you know, that I kind of thought differently. When I first started in my 20s, I did not know that other people did not think in pictures. I did not know that. I thought everybody thought the same way I did. And it just seemed obvious to get down in the chutes and see what cattle were seeing. And to other people, that wasn't obvious. But I found if you took got the chain out of there, or maybe this little gate that's there jiggling, or there's a hose laying across the floor, that if you move those things, the animals would move more easily. You know, and then in my 30s and 40s, that's when I started discovering that my thinking was different. Now, visual thinking is a continuum. All right, let's try a little visual thinking test. Think about a church steeple. How does it come into your mind? I was shocked to find out that a lot of people that are very verbal just see a pointy thing, very general. I only see specific pictures. You know, the person that tends to be more of a visual thinker tends to start naming them off where they're located. It's very specific. Well, I was probably late 30s, early 40s before I realized that. You know, in this, in my talk tonight, I'm going to be talking about the different kinds of minds. I'm the visual thinking mind. Other people are more the mathematical thinking mind. But again, you want to understand animals, you need to get away from language. So to shut your eyes. What is your animal seeing? What is it hearing? What is it smelling? It's a sensory-based world. It's not a word-based world. Okay? Well, a part of the thing that's a big issue is when people are held accountable for losses, they do something about it. Okay, a feed yard has got more motivation supervise the cattle handling when the cattle come in, because that's going to affect the bottom line. Okay, if a feed yard is selling the cattle live weight, and they cross the scale on the feed yard property, and then when they go on those trucks, they no longer own them, you've lost the financial incentive to care about that. That was the first piece of research I ever did. Bruises on southwestern feed yard cattle. An abstract I did in 1981. And cattle sold live weight, where the packing plant paid for the bruises, had twice as many bruises as cattle sold in the carcass, where the feed yard ownership changed in the cooler. Well, I'm afraid that's still going on today. I'm kind of discouraged about this latest paper on Journal of Animal Science. Truck driver behavior. That's not very good. So a lot of it gets down to holding people accountable for losses. Let's look at another problem area, and that is people weaning beef calves on the truck. That's a problem out west. Wean the calves, throw the bull and babies on the truck, no vaccinations. Yeah, I guarantee you they're going to get sick a week later. But unless that rancher gets a premium price, he's not going to want to spend the money to vaccinate those calves. See, this is where segmented markets are still contributing to a lot of losses. Now, what made the plants really clean up their act? When you got a big customer saying you got to clean it up, that makes them do it. I hate to say it, they were forced. I know that's not what people want to hear. The other thing on cattle handling, which was sometimes frustrating, is I had situations where I actually demonstrated savings, but you sometimes get minds set in cement. That is getting better now. There is getting to be a lot more awareness. You know, the beef quality assurance, they've really been pushing a lot of low-stress handling stuff. So, the feed yard handling shown that that's better. Stuff like the cancerized stuff's gotten better. That's good. You know, there's some things that are gradually getting better. But there's also some things like weaning calves on the truck. In certain parts of the West is still a gigantic problem. Well, I know how to get, everyone knows how to get rid of bovine respiratory disease. Yeah, it's called pre-wean and pre-vaccinate. Yes. Well, I would rather, I think it would be really unwise to build any new gestation stall facilities. Well, let's just talk about handling stuff, because that's a lot of the problems with handling are management issues. Well, okay, we're loading pigs out. We're going to have to enforce moving small groups. You don't load out 15 at a time. You load out 5 at a time. People that abuse animals, you got to get rid of them. We just got to make sure that, I mean, now every phone's a video camera. And there's been some pretty ugly videos that have gone up. Actually, the worst videos that are up right now in dairy. And unfortunately, they're like the toughest nut to crack on some of this stuff. Yeah, there's some pig videos up, but they're not as bad as the dairy videos. We just got to make sure, first of all, we aren't doing something on the farm that would really look awful on a cell phone video, like beating pigs up with gate rods. I mean, I'm talking about total basics here. I mean, stuff that every good producer knows is bad. But the thing that frustrates me is I went in the chicken plant that was absolutely perfect. A week later, PETA got in there, and they were seeing how many chickens they could shackle at once. You know, 3 birds on a shackle? I mean, come on now. That's not best practices. And they were playing games with it. Well, you see, that gets down to management. The first thing we got to do is, the other thing we got to do is not understaff and overwork, where people get so tired, they just don't care about how they do stuff. I've been there. I remember cattle vaccinating crews where I was so tired, Franklin pistol grip syringe, I remember that. So tired, didn't care what you were doing. And some of these truck drivers that are behaving badly, I think are overworked. They're making too many trips. Because they're coming in like they're wired on speed or something, and they've got to make a lot of trips. I think some of the managers need to get out there and find out, well, how many trips can a truck driver make a day reasonably and do it decently? And maybe it's going to have to be one less trip. I think that's stuff we're going to have to look at. Always you got to have time to back his truck in properly. You know, the low stress handling methods maybe take a little bit longer to do, but they prevent wrecks. Because when you have a real smack up with cattle, then it takes you, you might have a dead animal, a crippled animal, or take half an hour to get the animal unstuck from the fence or whatever mess you ended up having. But that's what we got to do just on the handling things. Is how's this going to, how if what I'm doing right now, how's that going to play on YouTube? Okay, right there. Oh, yeah, cattle definitely have hierarchies. Yes, most animals will have dominance hierarchies. And when you have huge groups of animals, like maybe 300 cattle in a feedlot pen, they tend to set up hierarchy, you know, subgroups within a yard. And why do animals form dominance hierarchies? It prevents constant fighting. You know, once they kind of make a stable hierarchy, well, then they eat in the order of the hierarchy. And then when the dominant animal starts to get old and weak, you know, then somebody will come, another one will come and challenge it. But dominance hierarchies actually help to make peace. And most animals that live in social groups do have dominance hierarchies. And they're not always completely linear. No, that's just a basic thing in animal behavior. Okay. Who inspired me? Well, when I was in high school and I was not studying, I had a really good science teacher. And there's a scene in the movie where I saw the optical illusion room. That actually happened. I always say, to get kids interested in interesting things, you got to show them interesting stuff. If I hadn't gone to my aunt's ranch, I would have never have gotten involved in the cattle industry. You know, there's a lot of kids, they're kind of quirky and different, where agriculture would be a great thing for them to be in. I think it's disgusting that Illinois cut the funding for FFA. Is that still true? You know, what is an ag state thinking of, you know, doing that? You know, we need young people going into agriculture. You know, we've got to get, I'm seeing too many kids that get labeled dyslexic, autistic, you know, ADHD, getting addicted to video games. And they're not going into the video game field. They're just getting addicted to video games. They're not going anywhere. We need to be getting a lot more emphasis, and this is getting into my talk tonight, on when kids are 12 or 13 years old on learning job skills. Okay, now the kids that are coming off the farm, they're going to learn that in the farm. But the other kids, I'm seeing kids graduate in college that have never held a job, even a volunteer job. That needs to start at around 12. When I was 13, my mother got me set up to do a little sewing job. And when I was 15, I was cleaning horse stalls every day. I learned work skills. And I'm seeing a very big problem with that. Kids that in the 50s we just called quirky and different, you know, now they're called mild autism, ADHD, dyslexic, and get kind of a handicap mentality. Well, half of Silicon Valley's on the autism spectrum. I was just out at the Googleplex. Oh, they keep their Googlers get lots of free food, and they get to ride pastel bikes around. They got climbing walls and all that kind of good stuff like that. That's where the lucky ones get to go. Well, the Googleplex is a really fun place. And how do they keep them thin on all that free food? They ride bikes. I'll tell you, the desserts are only this big. Little tiny brownies like that. And they don't put that many of them out, so if you took like five of them, they'd look at you like you're a pig. And you can eat all you want of healthy food. Okay, I'm going to pick somebody. Okay, right there. Okay, so they're going, they're dropping on their knees in the squeeze chute. So you just have a head catch and there's no squeeze chute. Okay. What you might do is put a brisket bar in there. Now, if your chute leading up to it is just straight-sided, like about this far apart, you can put a brisket bar in that's about this far off the ground, that about like that. And that sometimes will help to prevent them from laying down. See, a lot of cattle that do a lot of laying down at some time in their life, sometimes they've been nutcrackered by the head gate, and they tend to do that. But a brisket bar might help that. Now, if you have a squeeze chute that's V-shaped at the bottom, then the brisket bar is not going to work because they won't be able to walk in there. I've seen people try to have a V-shaped squeeze chute and a brisket bar. That does not work. You either go straight sides with the brisket bar or you get a squeeze chute that goes like that. And then that stops her from laying down. You get a complete squeeze chute. Okay. You have students, okay. Okay, you're having problems with behavior in undergraduates? College students? What class are you teaching? You have juniors and seniors in college and they're misbehaving in class? I think it gets down to, you're saying your students aren't turning in assignments and things like that. When I was in high school, I was that way. I was not motivated. And then finally, when I got motivated for the goal of becoming a scientist, I pulled it together and started studying. I think some of these students, we've got to give them a reason to be motivated through school. One thing I do in talking to students, I go, now, what are your career goals? What do you want to do? And I would sit down, I'd get some of these students one at a time up in your office and say, you know, you're doing bad in my class. Let's just talk about why you're in this class. What do you want to do with your life? You know, learning how to write is a pretty basic skill. If you're doing a basic writing class, and the only way students are going to learn how to write is you got to write papers and then have you mark them up with red marks, copy edit the work. That's how I learned how to write. You're doing them a great favor if you actually copy edit the work. But some of these kids, you know, you're going to need to be saying, what do you want to do with yourself? Because you're teaching a pretty basic class, writing. There's other more specialized classes. It might be a requirement that they think is stupid or something, but writing is essential. And they've got to get it through their head that getting an education is important. One at a time, hopefully you have the time to do that. Some little heart-to-heart talks about where does this kid want to go in their life? Because I went from being a horrible student that did no studying, turning it right around once I had a goal. Then I did turn in my homework. And then I found that, I go, well, why do I have to take world literature? I didn't want to take the class because it wasn't in my major. Well, it ended up being my best class. I ended up loving it. You know, I think some of these kids, sit them down and say, now, what do you want to do with your life? Especially if you're messing up a class like writing. Which, I mean, is such an important skill you've got to have no matter what job you have. Okay, I'm sure we'd like to do a few more questions. Oh, I can't see him. Okay, in the back.
As more large companies like Tyson, for instance, try to take ownership of a word like sustainable, what can cattle farmers expect that they'll need to accomplish on their own farm to meet a company's definition of a word like sustainable?
Well, sustainable is going to get to be a real controversial word. Well, that's the problem. That is the problem. You know, when I've written a lot of guidelines, when I wrote the AMI guideline, I've also been worked with AVMA on the euthanasia guidelines. And one thing I emphasize is, and some people think it's negative, but I think it's being practical. Let's put down some things that sustainability is not. Letting a lagoon go in the river. That's definitely not sustainable. Overgrazing a pasture and wrecking it. I mean, there's some definite things that I think everyone could agree are not sustainable things to do. Starving your cows. You're not going to be in business if you did that. Some people think that's negative. But I think it's kind of being practical. You know, then you get into things like greenhouse gases. Frank Mitlohner, University of California, Davis, he really did a good job of ripping apart livestock's long shadow. That FAO report said that livestock were responsible for 18% of greenhouse gases, which is absolute garbage. See, and the problem that you had with that is that when they calculated the figures, they used the entire life cycle of the cow. But for the car, they just used the burning of the gas. They didn't do the whole car life cycle, which would include steel mining, oil refinery, and all of that kind of stuff. Now, if you take EPA figures, livestock is responsible for only 3%, like 3.4%, 3% of greenhouse gases. I think all of ag is 6 or 7% in the U.S. You know, then you get into issues like, you know, intensification of agriculture, especially for pigs and chickens, is less carbon footprint. But on the other hand, if you look at a map of the world, the percentage of the world's land that's good cropland, and unfortunately, some of your good cropland is growing too many shopping centers and things like that. The percentage of good cropland is a very small amount of land. And you look at all the land out there, and I come from the West, that the only thing you could grow on that land is grazing animals. That, to me, has got to be part of sustainable agriculture, even though the greenhouse gases they emit will be slightly higher. But when you look at transportation and energy, I mean, that's a gigantic gorilla in the room. That was like 60, more than 60% of it. You know, you got to kind of look at the whole system. I don't think not using grazing lands would be very sustainable when that's such a huge portion of the world's land. You know, well, I think the first thing we need to be doing is let's make sure we're not doing stuff that's definitely not sustainable. A mud hole, crap hole of a feed yard that's running off in a stream, wrecking pasture with overgrazing, things like that. We've got to, you know, deal with some, make sure we're not doing stuff like that. Okay, there's a question there. I'm sorry, I couldn't see you. Well, when I gave my first presentation in graduate school, I panicked and walked out. And I have graduate students that get panicky about doing their papers at the Animal Science Society meeting. And I said, make sure you got really good slides. And then the worst thing that happens when you're doing that 10-minute presentation, you read your slides. If your slides are crappy, then you're really in trouble. And one of the problems that I had is I didn't have slides. So one of the things I started doing is making sure I got really good slides together. And I got invited to do some presentations, and I got invited to do some more presentations. You know, it's just like how I started out writing articles for our State Farm magazine. Start out one little article at a time. You know, sometimes you just get into things. The other thing is, oftentimes doors to opportunity will open, and people don't see them. You know, there's a scene in the movie where I walk up to the editor of the Fire Arrangement and I get his card. I actually did that. I just was gutsy enough to do that. That was one of the things that helped get me started in the cattle industry, was writing for that magazine. Okay, I recommend getting out and trying lots of stuff. You have to go to a wedding or something in another state, get out and see some farms, get out and try things. Start doing, you know, job-related things while you're still in high school. I'm a big believer in trying on careers. You know, like there's a lot of people who want to be a veterinarian. Well, then you need to intern in the veterinarian office, see if that's what you really want to do. In fact, our veterinary school won't touch you unless you've done that, because they want to make sure that you've tried on the career and you're going to like it. Okay? Misuse of antibiotics? Well, that gets to be a real controversial question. The thing that I found on misuse of a lot of things is there's relatively few people that do something really irresponsible that make a ton of trouble for everybody else. Now, I have an abstract for an article in my bag that I got out of Science and Nature magazine about weird stuff going on in the soil. And if there's going to be a problem, it's not eating the meat that's not the issue. It's that when the cattle and the pigs, the manure goes out on the land, there's strange things in the soil. And there's actually a place where it needs to be more research money put into that. But, you know, people might be a little scared of what they might find out. Let's just finish up with a little thing about genetics. When I was at the University of Illinois in the 80s, they would talk about junk DNA. You know, only 1 or 2% of the DNA codes for proteins, the rest was junk. I never believed that. Well, now the ENCODE project in 2012, they know that that's regulatory DNA. It is the gene's operating system. It tells all the other coding DNA what to do. Well, you know what? We don't know how it works. But they do know that you've seen the double helix, so like a long string. But when you fold that up and you put it in the sperm on the egg, it's all folded up and it goes against each other. And coding DNA goes up against non-coding DNA in some sort of mathematical system. That's the operating system. Well, nobody knows how that works yet. You know, Mendel's maybe only about 25% of genetics. My personal priorities, no, antibiotics is not at the top of my personal priorities. Handling and stuff is. But I've got this abstract that I got in my bag. If you want to see it, I'll show it to you. If there's going to be a problem, it's going to be on the land. It's not the meat. It's a scary article about transfer resistance that I thought I'd better copy and put the abstract in my bag. But we've got to make sure we don't do the irresponsible stuff. Because there's so many things where there's a few people that do something really irresponsible, like, okay, take this chemical spill. They let a tank of chemicals spill into the water supply. Well, that's now made a real mess for all the other companies that store chemicals. How about these trains that have derailed? They had the wrong kind of rail cars, and you burned up a town and, you know, mess like that. You know, we have those oil trains going right through my town, 3 miles from my house. Brand new rail cars, I hope they're the right kind. Because I get to sit at the rail crossing and I get to see all these delicious things that are in these cars, like chlorine. I go, man, that doesn't tip over while I'm sitting there at the crossing. They'll read what's in all these cars. I go, yuck. Goes right through downtown Fort Collins. Well, it's been going through Fort Collins safely for 24 years, for as long as I've been there. But it only take one idiot to do something stupid and have one of those tip over, or it's the wrong kind of car. And if it's the wrong kind of car, then it breaks and you're in trouble. You know, those are the kind of things I tend to read on planes. I find that really interesting. I find that stuff interesting. Okay. Want to thank everybody for coming.
Okay, Dr. Grandin will be up here. She'll sign books if you'd like, or if you have questions you want to ask her one-on-one, please do that. I want to mention to the students here that we have an opportunity to take the Polar campus tour with some admissions folks. That was a joke. And we will also have some refreshments in the lobby, so please hang around and talk with Dr. Grandin, and thank you so much for coming to Eureka College.